Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to everyone that is attending to this panel. My name is Tiago Peres, and I will be the moderator of this panel. Satellite navigation is today deeply embedded in our society. It improves our life in many different ways, and sometimes in ways that we are not even aware of it. But here, the focus at the Portugal Air Summit, the focus is aviation. So the question that this panel will try to answer is, how is satellite navigation improving aviation? To help us answer this question, we have four speakers today. So remotely connected, we have Catarina Strelkova from the European Union Space Programme Agency, Teresa Ferreira from GMV, Catarina Bastos from Deimos, and Jesus Conde from NAV Portugal. So I will thank you everyone for your presence here. And perhaps I will start with Catarina. So Catarina, EOSPA core mission is to implement the European Union Space Programme. EOSPA also manages EGNOS and Galileo and plays a key role on this program. So I would invite you to present us Galileo and EGNOS and how they improve aviation. So Catarina, please, the floor is yours.
Perfect. Thank you very much, Tiago. Good afternoon to everyone, and thanks for this intro and having me here today. I hope that you can hear me well. So at the first slide, I would like to just introduce who we are, because most of you know us as GSA, the European GNSS Agency. However, from May 2020, we became EUSPA, European Union Space Programme Agency. Following the EU space regulation that started this year, and also thanks to the increased importance of space, we are receiving more and more responsibility. That's why the EUSPA was created. And what we do here, you can see on the slide a big building, still with the old logo. So we are still at the same building, just the logo has changed. Also, you can see our team on the picture, but this team is also increasing, and it will triple in the next years. And what we do, we basically ensure the operations and service provision. We are also the gatekeeper of the security, and we are developing the market for the use of GNSS, and right now for the whole EU space program, so also for Copernicus and GovSatcom. So if we take a look at the whole EU space program, so basically, as I said, from 2021, right now with the new regulation, the previous agency became the EUSPA, right now we have all the EU space activities under one umbrella. So as Tiago mentioned, we are managing the Galileo, that is a global satellite navigation and positioning system. Then also we are managing EGNOS, that is basically the European geostationary navigation system, improving the performances of GPS currently, but also of EGNOS in the future. And also where we are looking at right now is the Copernicus, that is the Earth observation and monitoring based on the satellite and non-space data. And this is the number one world provider of space data and information. So here we are looking, we are working intensively right now to bring the new commercial applications and solutions using Copernicus. We are also working on the EU GovSatcom, that is the secure satellite communication for the EU security actors. And if we look at the EGNOS, this will be the main topic, EGNOS and Galileo, during today's conference, because they are the biggest contributors to navigation in aviation nowadays. So EGNOS is the standardized by ICAO and meets the requirement to enable LPV approaches that are localizer performance with vertical guidance, that are operationally equivalent to ILS CAT-1, without a need to have any ground equipment or infrastructure. EGNOS in general brings several safety, economic and operational benefits to aviation stakeholders. We might talk about it a little bit later, but I will right now list a few of them. From the safety perspective, EGNOS is providing vertical guidance to almost all the runways or is increasing the accessibility basically during the bad weather conditions when there is no other navigation means available. From the economic point of view, with EGNOS we can save a lot from reduction of disruption. Also, thanks to more flexible procedure designs, we can decrease the fuel burn. And from the operational perspective, we have basically more closer alternates, alternate airports when we are planning our mission with the CAT-1 operations. And if we take a look at the specific solutions and applications that we can achieve by EGNOS and Galileo by satellite navigation, EGNOS is becoming the main mean basically for navigation in aviation, especially for the small and bigger aerodromes at all the instrument runway ends. If you look at the slide, basically EGNOS-based procedures are planned to be at all instrument runway ends by 2024 and have its exclusive use by 2030 that is mandated by EU regulation. On the top, EGNOS is also, or also Galileo, is answering user needs of new users. So we are bringing the satellite navigation to helicopter operations for the emergency medical services, also to general aviation, that there are no that there is no navigation infrastructure at the moment. And last, GNSS is also supporting the creation of the new mobility schemes, such as urban air mobility, where there is very high demand for accurate and robust navigation. And if you look where we are now, right now we have almost 800 EGNOS-based procedures in Europe at more than 100 aerodromes. Also, our fleet is becoming EGNOS capable, and we have more than 1,700 aircraft equipped with EGNOS in Europe. You can see on the right side basically the extensive list of the operators that have already EGNOS on board. If we look in the future, of course, Galileo and its differentiators like OSNMA or high accuracy are playing a very important role and will contribute not just to the manned aviation, but also to the urban air mobility. And we have several projects on it in order to implement and test it. And here I would like to just close with the message. We are a user-driven agency. And users are the ones that are shaping the future and are the decision makers, so what kind of technology they will use. So we have several projects and initiatives where we collect the user and user needs, discuss them, report within the several working groups and user fora how we are basically improving and designing the system based on the user needs.
Okay.
And that's it from my side for the introduction, and I guess the rest will be discussed during the panel.
Thank you, Katrina, for this complete overview. I see that the clock is ticking, so we need to move fast, quite fast. So I will leave the questions to the end if we have time, and I will jump for our representatives of industry here. So. Together here with us, we have Therese and Catarina from GMV and Deimos. And these two companies have been working in Galileo and EGNOS since a long time ago. So I will start to invite Therese. Therese, what can you tell us about what activities is GMV performing now that are contributing to aviation and to EGNOS and to Galileo?
Thank you. Thank you very much, Tiago, for the question. Thank you also for the invitation. Good afternoon, everyone. To those here and also there online. Could you please put up the presentation? Maybe it's there. No. Okay, so in any case, I'm Teresa Ferreira again on behalf of GMV. Thank you for the invitation. I will start, eventually the presentation will come, so I will start. GMV is a multinational technological company. We've been founded in 1984. Today we are over 2,300 people worldwide, and we have a 265 million euro revenue per year. So in Portugal, we are over 11 countries, but in Portugal, we are about 120 people. And so therefore, we've been growing steadily since a long time again. We started in the space domain, now we're working also aeronautics, defense, security, IT, and also transportation. So regarding GNSS, GMV has been working over 30 years in GNSS, so we are very proud to be able to have helped design and develop the Galileo and the EGNOS system that Catherine was talking about. Today we are managing, operating, and we have developed some of their infrastructures, the Galileo and the EGNOS infrastructures, not only in the mission segment, but also we are priming the Galileo control segment. So this is one of the main flags we're heading. We're also operating some of the centers, the Galileo centers. We're working in the user technology as well, in the user domain. And we are our offer is very large, for example, in terms of timing and validation products. So without the presentation, it's difficult because I really would like to share with you a picture.
Perhaps I'll take this opportunity to put a question. Yes. So you mentioned this activity related with the Galileo control ground segment. This is a very large activity. What are the challenges that GMV faces with this kind of contracts? What kind of channels can you tell us, and how important is this, for instance, this activity and Galileo for aviation?
Yes, one of the main challenges is really the time that it takes. So when you are designing Galileo and when you are deploying Galileo, it takes a long time. So in fact, there is obsolescence of the systems. So you need to maintain and to upgrade the full ground segment continuously, while guaranteeing all the performance and the service, continuity, availability, and so on, that the users are expecting. So this is quite a challenge in that way. And in fact, this is something that we've been being able to achieve step by step, and actually we've reached a very important milestone just recently about that. So what I would like to tell also is what is, from my point of view, what is GNSS in aviation? And for me, the main contribution is, in fact, integrity. So we understand what is the use of GNSS in a global way, but for me, integrity is a very interesting concept, and this is really an enabler for the aviation. This picture very quickly separates what is accuracy from integrity. This is something people sometimes confuse. But then integrity, the problem is to be able to bound the errors that we are having in our navigation solution and to guarantee that they are bounded. This is, of course, important for safety critical applications, as Katrina was just saying, and in aviation in particular. Another main point regarding aviation is, of course, the barriers regarding standardization and certification that you need to go through to be able to have your technological solutions deployed. So very quickly in the last slide, so now focusing on GMV and what is our contribution to aviation from a GNSS perspective. So I divided this in four topics. One of them is augmentation. So we have our operational test bench, which is Magic S-Bus, the product. And with this, we are helping regions to see and to analyze what would be the performance of an S-Bus system in case it would be deployed. So we are running long-term tests in different regions. We've done this in South America, in Russia, in South Africa with Sansa, and also in Australia. So this is something that we are very happy about to see, to deploy this kind of products. Regarding performance, we are very much engaged in helping ANSPs, for example, to assess performance in the airport's vicinities, either locally or in a centralized way. But sometimes, so they need to answer the question, what was the performance of the system locally, and what is the expectation? We can also help them to make some tests. For example, what if we were using RAIM, which is a very novel technology? So this allows the airports, the ANSPs, in fact, to be able to assess performance. Regarding monitoring, we are working very hardly on this. We have some products regarding interference monitoring, of course, according to the ICAO standard and so on. And we're also working in the signal quality monitoring. This includes evil waveforms. So basically to ensure that the signal is in fact as it's supposed to be. In the GRC, for example, we are doing this with directive antennas, but also we're working in novel ways to do this with omnidirectional antennas. And then finally, in the airports, we are using also GNSS to support the NSPs in the calibration and in the validation of some of the nav aids. For example, we can use GNSS to dramatically reduce the costs of calibrating an ILS or a VOR nav aids. So I hope to be able to have
indeed,
kept on mind.
Indeed, it was a very, very complete answer. Thank you. I mean, one of the takeaways that we take is that it is important to have confidence on the GNSS measures that we receive, and you see that GMB is committed in offer aviation protected levels that the aircraft operators can trust and trust GNSS messages. So I'll move to Catarina. Catarina, I'll ask you the same question. In which activities is DEMOS involved, and how are these activities contributed to Galileo and EGNOS, and how are they improving aviation?
Good afternoon, Tiago. Thank you very much for the invitation to be here. Indeed, DEMOS is also a multinational company included in the Elecnor Group, and we work for basically all time in the Galileo and the EGNOS activities. I also have some slides in our activities, if it's possible. Thank you. So answering to your question, so I think GNSS here and for the aviation, it's quite important to talk about Galileo, which was a starting point, and also the European constellation, of course, and is a key ingredient here in aviation. It was original plan to be a first GNSS system providing integrity, but after all, this was de-scoped in the early AOV phase. However, it becomes actually a key element to extend the capacities of augmentation systems. In DEMOS in particular, we are involved for 20 years in these activities, in particular here in Portugal in the GALC activities with Rome for the Galileo system evaluation and equipment. And in particular, we worked a lot in this tool, which is in the independent orbit and clocks estimation that helps to have an estimation of the orbits and the clock bias for then validate with test campaigns. We have nowadays a staff co-located there in Rome, in Tassai, to maintain this tool and to work in the GALC. We are also have collocation people in NESTEC working in the system and the performance of Galileo, and also some subcontractions in the activities related with the new signals from Galileo, the G2G, oriented more to the receivers. Of course, when we are talking about aviation, we are of course talking about EGNOS, and this is also another activity that we involved for a long time. We have been since the beginning when EGNOS V2 was certified and placed in support for the aeronautical. We have been working in the first phases until the new evolutions to EGNOS V3, basically in the subsystem and the system level, focusing always in the algorithms presented there and the performance related with this kind of activities. We have some activities also related with the receiver part, so using these EGNUS signals, or have an algorithm with EGNUS for the receiver, which is our EGNUS tour. And basically for EGNUS V3, there are some key aspects that we work a lot in DAIMUS, so basically to guaranteeing the support for the services of the legacy services, GPS L1, but also to improve the availability of these signals and the development and the upgrading for the dual frequency augmentation in GPS and also in the Galileo side. There's also some new features. We are also working now in this ARIM, so in this Advanced Receiver Autonomous Integrity Monitoring, with EGNUS is a regional service, so it's quite important now to have a system for aviation that could be with a global integrity. And so we are basically working in this activity, which is HARDEM, and where we are actually studying and optimizing an approach to have these integrity support messages there, where is the new parameters that we need for this kind of systems to help the aviation. The difference between the ARIM and EGNUS can complement each other, but the real difference here is the latency that we get the signals. Basically, in this kind of approach in ARIM, we have a low latency, so it's quite different. We are working also in the ARIM implementation algorithm in the EGNUS receiver, EGNUS tour, and we are in the development of the first prototype receiver for aviation using these methods of ARIM. Another example of activities that we are developing is use the EGNUS signals for the drones, which is this project Reality. And the DAIMUS is here involved analyzing the capacity and the future potential and limits of EGNUS and these EGNSS systems. And also another thing here in this project would be to identify and analyze other GNSS enhancements that could have special emphasis also for the contribution of ARIM. Finally, we have a lot of expertise in the part of the receivers. We are now developing receivers for ground, for aviation, and for space, and getting profit of this experience for the different areas. In the aviation with the DARP project, and also the user receivers using Galileo signals, and finally our G3 receiver that is basically being built for the space using the new signal from Galileo, a high accuracy service, to get more precision on the determination of the orbits. And from my side, it's also...
Thank you, Catherine. It's really good to know. It's good to know that both GMV and DAIMUS are working for Galileo and EGNUS. It's good to know that they're actually developed technology that can be used at airports and even on aircrafts. It's quite impressive. So perhaps now what is important to know is what can we do with this technology? And for this, we have here Jesus with us. So Jesus, you work for NAV. NAV is responsible for the air traffic manage here in Portugal. What can you tell us? What is your point of view? How is GNSS and satellite navigation improving your work and improving aviation?
Thank you, Diego, and thank you very much for your invitation, because NAV Portugal is an important player in the satellite navigation, especially in the implementation of the PBN concept. A new name of an old concept, because the concept was implemented a long time ago when GNSS appeared. Thank you. A new name of an old concept, because GNSS is not a new system. NAV Portugal is the main service provider in the Portuguese airspace, and it is an implementation for the airspace. So we are responsible for this implementation. We are sensitive to the GNSS and the satellite technology, and we know the advantage that can bring to our companies, our clients. The big experience for technical people and also the maturity of the system has offered the possibility to go ahead with a new regulation that I'm going to show you, that is important in the European airspace to decide a go ahead in order to introduce the PBN concept in Europe. In 2030, the new technology from the GNS will be the first technology to give us to our companies to do the navigation. Now, we are in a transition period from 2020 to 2030, in where conventional navigation will be survived with the GNS technology. And why NAV Portugal? NAV Portugal is the main service provider in the communication domain, surveillance domain, and in the air traffic management function. But the PBN concept is mainly focused in the navigation domain. What is PBN? PBN is a facilitator. It's just a facilitator using and taking full advantage of the maturity of the concept of the satellite. I would like to pay attention in the three main pillars of the technology: the NAVAID infrastructure, the navigation specification, and the navigation application. All of them to give continuity to the airspace concept of the ICAO. Navigation infrastructure, no doubt satellite will be the first navigation system in 2013. It is true that we still can use the conventional NAVAID. We will see what we're going to do in this rationalization process, because if satellites are the main systems, maybe we don't need to maintain all our NAVAID. But now, GPS, Galileo, and the augmentation systems will give us all the signal that onboard systems will need to do navigation. We have a good knowledge of satellites, a good knowledge of the coverage that is really perfect in non-partition approach, as you can see in the left image. And a good coverage for very high precision approach, but only in continental airspace. As we can see in the image, Azores Island is outside of the availability network of the GNSS. So we have a problem, because we can implement non-precision approaches, but maybe we cannot go deeper to take full advantage of the system, unfortunately. Another important pillar is the navigation specification. What is navigation specification? The onboard system of our traffic, our companies. Currently, ICAO has presented 11 navigation specifications. As you can see in the right column, you can see the precision of this navigation on board. This is very important. We will see why. Because we need to protect the trajectories of the aircraft, and this precision in nautical miles will give us an idea of how to protect these trajectories. These four rows in yellow are showing us what are the four main navigation onboard systems of our companies in Europe. We have 11 navigation specifications, because ICAO is a global concept. Maybe in the US, in Asia, in Africa, they use another navigation specification. In the case of Eurospace, we have these four main onboard systems. We are very sensitive with these onboard systems, and we are really interested to know that which companies are applying and are installing these kind of onboard systems. As you can see in the image, in the Portugal continental aerodromes, nearly 100% of the traffic is already capable of doing the most precise approaches. This is the RNP approach. As we can see in the Azores Islands, we are not completing the 100%. And it's interesting to see Cascais Airport, the typology of the airport in Cascais. Only 50% of the traffic, mainly the business jets, are only capable of these much more precise systems. And finally, two main technological pillars. And the third one, navigation application, is our main pillar, is the en route and navigation application. Where we are going to apply all this technology, all these concepts in the European airspace? Mainly, in a simple way, We are going to divide the European airspace in three main areas: the route upper airspace area, in the lower airspace, the approach airspace, 15 nautical miles around airports, and between the route and the approach airspace, we will create a transitional airspace. We call it terminal airspace. This is an important situation. In the top, the low performance navigation on board, mostly dedicated to the low performance requirement airspace, mainly the upper airspace, the route one and the terminal one, and the most precise technical requirements will be dedicated to the approach, the most critical phase of the plane. How do we apply? Very simple example in Portugal. We, in 2009, we were the first country in Europe implementing free route airspace. Free route is full GNSS. We eliminate all the routes, so no supporting of navigational aid. If you want to fly free route, if you want to take advantage of free route, use GNSS, in this case, AirNav 5 navigation specification. You see the rest of Europe with hundreds of routes, not really efficient. And in our case, our clean airspace using taking full advantage of GNSS. Advantage, it is quite easy to see in this example, before of free route airspace and now direct line from entry to exit in our airspace. Main benefits, millions of euros of benefit for the companies, nautical miles, and most important also for the environment, more than 50,000 tons of CO2 emissions that we advantage with the new GNSS systems. The new regulation I mentioned before, we already done the upper space implementation. Now, two main objectives, terminal space, the approach objective. The system is mature, it's ready to be implemented. The European Commission knows, and now we, it is mandatory in Europe to implement GNSS. Two main articles, exclusive use of PBN. Now service provider will have to guarantee our service provision with GNSS. This is mandatory from 2030. And as a secondary, as a contingency measure, we can use still the conventional just for contingency procedures. So we will have to maintain a small portion of our service just with conventional. The most important thing of this implementation, as we saw before with the navigation specification, 11 specifications, the Commission was really clear. If you want to fly in Europe, in the upper airspace, AirNav 5. In terminal airspace, AirNav 1. And if you want to fly in the approach, AirNav approach. So any plane in the world that want to fly in Europe, Portugal, they will have to be accomplished with this navigation specification. So it is very clear for us, as procedure designers, service providers, and also for the companies. So they don't need to buy other navigation specifications that are very expensive. So only three navigation specifications from 11 to be accomplished with Europe. In our case, this is very difficult for the airspace department. What do we do to protect traffic, to guarantee the safety? If we want to go deeper, if we want to reduce minimum, we need to reduce the tolerance. This is much more difficult. This is stressful for us. A lot of training. This is a trade-off. Big benefits, but at the same time, big work. So for us, the big difference between conventional and AirNav navigation, PBN, is the extremely workload that gives us to us. As you can see in the right image, it's a real example in Santa Maria Airport. But pay attention to the tolerance areas. We are using the most precise navigation, and still, big tolerance areas are higher minimums for the traffic, which is not a good expectations. Finally, now Portugal, according to this regulation in Europe, we have presented the transition plan, 10-year strategy plan, to create the most exciting and much more important restructuration project of the Portuguese airspace. This is essential to give the expectations of the traffic. Expectations, flexibility, safety, cost, and environment. We believe that the implementation of GNSS will bring us much more security, even with a reduced tolerance areas and higher minimums, better quality of the service of NAV Portugal, and at the same time, maybe to facilitate the improvement of the capacity of the system. That is all. Okay.
Thank you, Jesus. It's quite impressive. So we see that satellite navigation is not only improving security, but it's actually help us reducing the carbon emissions and I guess also reducing the fuel costs for aircraft operators. So in the future, will the legacy radio navigation signals, will they be completely replaced by satellite navigation, or will they still coexist? And also another question, do you have any number about the number of approaches that are performed in Portugal using satellite navigation only? Mm-hmm.
As you see previously in the free route airspace, free route is only mandatory in 2022. So for the next year, we did in 2009. So we anticipate the mandatory obligation of the European Commission. We already did the same for the approach in Portugal. We have several approaches with RNP. We have in Porto, Lisbon, Faro, Madeira, Ponta Delgada, Horta. Many airports already. Other airports will follow. We are now working in Flores, Graciosa, Santa Maria, Porto Santo, to be approved by ANAC. So much earlier than 2030, Portugal will be all with GNSS to be flyed by the companies that, as we have seen, they are already accomplishing the mandatory obligation of the regulation.
Okay, thank you. Catarina, probably I'll come back to you to one question. Which aviation users do you think that will benefit the most from satellite navigation? How many aircraft do you think that in the future will have this system installed on board?
So I hope
you are muted, Catarina. Okay, we can hear you now.
Perfect. Thank you for this question. I hope that all the aviation stakeholders and users will basically benefit from EGNOS and Galileo. What I see now, as Jesus said, basically right now we have the perfect system for navigation, for the basically instrument runway ends, where there was this mandate mentioned PBN implementation rule. So we really expect the exclusive use of GNSS to all these airports from 2030. However, there is a lot of benefits also to other users, like helicopters, especially emergency services, and also to general aviation, because at this moment, sometimes if you want to land at the hospital, to the heliport of the hospital, you don't have any place for the conventional navigation. And in case you are at the place that you have very bad weather conditions, sometimes you cannot bring the patients to the hospital. So here we can see really huge benefit from the safety perspective that of EGNOS, that EGNOS can really bring you during the bad weather conditions to the lower minima where you can land with the helicopter to the hospital. So this is, we had several pilot projects. There is several implementations in Europe already. We were even happy to have the pilot project here in Prague at the Motel Hospital last year. And then the second kind of new user is general aviation, because right now a lot of general pilots are basically flying visually, just by what they see from the window. And we really believe, especially with EASA, with whom we cooperate on this topic a lot, that EGNOS or GNSS navigation can really bring a huge value to these general pilots, where you are basically, where there is no navigation available, where you have usually even no air traffic control available. So right now we are designing the guidance material for these approaches in order to basically motivate or to show how these procedures, EGNOS procedures, can be implemented at these small aerodromes without an infrastructure, even without air traffic control, and by these to increase instrument flying to these small aerodromes. And also we are starting some pilot projects in order to demonstrate that these concepts are feasible, so like that all the member states can learn from these first examples. And then the second question was, I think, about the future equipage of the European fleet. So as I was presenting on my slides.
I'll ask you to be very brief because we are running out of time.
Sure. So as we will have the exclusive use of GNSS in the future after 2030, we have to ensure that basically majority of the operators will be equipped. There is a lot of projects with developing of the EGNOS solution on board, and we can see really a huge increase of the implementation of the EGNOS avionics on board. So I believe that it will be just growing. With the new aircrafts, it will be already in the majority of the new aircrafts, EGNOS will be already implemented in the ordered aircraft, basically. So the GNSS will be there.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for the answer. Thank you all for your presence here today. And we have to finish because we ran out of time. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.